Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 16th meeting of 2015 of the Public Petitions Committee. Can I start by reminding everyone present to close down their mobile phones and Blackberries completely, because they do affect the sound system. This morning we've received apologies from Anzala Malik, which I'd like to put on the record. Our first agenda item is seeking the committee's agreement to take agenda items 5 and 6 on a new petition and on witness expenses in private. Does the committee agree that that's okay?
Agreed.
Thank you. Agenda item 2 is consideration of petition PE1517 by Elaine Holmes and Olive McIlroy on behalf of the Scottish Mesh Survivors Hear Our Voice campaign on mesh medical devices. Members have a note from the clerk on this petition. I'd like to welcome Neil Findlay, MSP, and John Scott, MSP, to the meeting, both of whom have an interest in this petition. We are taking evidence on the petition today in two panels. And I welcome the first panel to the meeting. That's Dr. Lesley Wilkie, the Chair of the Independent Review of Transvaginal Mesh Implants. Dr. Wilkie is accompanied today by Dr. Rachael Wood from NHS Information Services Division and Dr. Phil Mackie from the Scottish Public Health Network. I'd now like to invite Dr. Wilkie to make a short opening statement, after which we'll move to questions. So over to you, Dr. Wilkie. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Convener, and good morning, members, and members behind me and people behind me. I want to thank the committee for this opportunity to discuss the interim report of the Independent Review of Transvaginal Mesh Implants. We've published an interim report at this time, as we have carried out an extensive body of work. Already, Lex has made recommendations and actions to improve patient care in this area. And we hope that it is possible to begin as soon as possible, and with certain lots of provisos, to put these proposed actions in place. This review into the use of transvaginal mesh surgery for stress incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse came about because of growing public concern, as you know, about the number of women experiencing serious and life-disabling complications. And I think women felt their voice had not been heard as they raised concerns about the complications a number of them had suffered. Bringing a petition to this committee was a way of bringing these concerns to a wider arena. And as a result of those concerns, the then Cabinet Secretary, Alex Neil, set up this independent review. And he charged the review to take an objective look at all the routine and published evidence, listening and valuing concerns, both of those in the Scottish Mesh Survivors Group with serious and disabling complications, and those women who had found the operation an effective solution to troubling and serious problems. Stress urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse can severely impact on the physical, psychological, and social well-being of women, and can have a profound effect on the quality of their lives. The use of mesh procedures to treat these conditions began in about 2000-2001. They were introduced then in an effort to improve effectiveness, reduce complications, and prevent repeat surgery. And we were asked to review the best available research evidence, statistics, and both patient and expert opinion to find out the nature and scope of the problem causing concern and to establish the facts as far as was possible concerning transvaginal mesh procedures. As well as taking objective view of both the results of the research and of the statistical analysis, we have also examined what they did not tell us, what was missing, what the patient's stories can tell us, and what the experience and knowledge of clinicians in practice can tell us. And I want to say a bit about each of these strands. Chapter 3 of the report has tried to capture the experiences of women who have undergone such surgery. And I know members will have read this and really quite upsetting stories it contains. For women who have suffered serious complications, their stories describe painful and debilitating experiences, often experienced years after their surgery, and then distressingly, at times not being believed when they sought help. We also heard from women of good outcomes where mesh surgery had been successful. And understandably, the review heard fewer of these, as if they'd been less likely to come forward after a good outcome. And both condition and surgery remain a personal and private experience. This chapter confirmed that some adverse outcomes experienced by women can profoundly affect their everyday lives. Where women have experienced a positive outcome, this was reported as strongly as those with an negative outcome. However, in the absence of specific qualitative research, the largest proportion of women who have had missed surgery have not shared their personal experiences. Chapter 4 presents an objective epidemiological review of the information from routine health data led by Dr. Wood of Information Services Division. And she has joined me today and I'll be able to answer any questions you have later. This is a key piece of evidence for which we are particularly lucky in Scotland, I may say, of having this available to us, which has analysed health data over a 15-year period and reveals the complex decisions that clinicians are presented with when considering the best treatment options for women. Chapter 5 presents an objective review of the research literature, for which I'm grateful to Dr. Mackie on my left here, for my right here, from the Scottish Public Health Network. A review of evidence undertaken by those agencies responsible for the safety of medical devices on an international and national basis, and the second peer-reviewed Cochrane Systematic Reviews in Health Technology Assessments. Phil has joined me today and will be able to answer any questions on this work. The conclusions of this evidence confirms that this is a complex area, and decision-making, as often in medical practice, is a balance between benefit and risk. Our conclusions emerging from this wide evidence review also reflect a balance. We have concluded that robust clinical governance should surround treatment of these conditions, and therefore management of patients should be carried out in the context of multidisciplinary team assessment. Good information is crucial to this process, and another recommendation refers to that. Evidence of clinician involvement in this process, including audit activity and the reporting of adverse events, should form an important part of the formal appraisal process already in place in the NHS. And we wish Scottish Government to review the options given for adverse event capture to determine the most effective way of doing this and improving its uptake. A considerable body of work on informed consent, which was highlighted as a major concern within the literature, has already taken place, and we wish that to now be reassessed in the light of the review and extended to the other procedures. The lack of studies, research studies, looking at long-term outcomes, including outcomes on quality of life and activities of daily living, is a concerning, and we conclude that research on this basis is a priority. There is a need for an information system which is universal, robust, clinically sound, and focused on good patient outcomes. ISD has already started work on the essential preparatory work on improved coding of procedures. Good communication in healthcare is essential to good patient care, and we see an educational need to ensure that adequate knowledge of these procedures, their uses, and potential complications and included in educational programmes, and they should embrace that with the encouragement, additionally, of good listening skills. In our final conclusions, we differentiate between the use of mesh in the treatment of stress urinary incontinence and when it is used in the repair of pelvic organ prolapse. While we await the outcome of the PROSPECT study, which is looking at mesh used to treat pelvic organ prolapse, as a group we considered we had sufficient evidence to express concern at the use of transvaginal mesh surgery for pelvic organ prolapse, and have concluded therefore that it should only be considered in the context of that multidisciplinary team assessment. The clinical experts on the group have also further reviewed the evidence on stress urinary incontinence mesh procedures together with their clinical experience and considered the clinical significance of the complications reported. We conclude from this and from the patient evidence that the retropubic approach is preferred when offering routine surgery for women with stress urinary incontinence. We have recommended that the expert group, which has already been set up, oversees the implementations of an improved way of working and of organising services. We are aware that we have still to publish our final report, but consider there is sufficient evidence to start in that expert group developing services and implementing the recommendations based on the evidence presented in this report. As chairman, I hope that this report goes some way towards ensuring that, above all, that patient voices continue to be heard, believed and valued, and that women with these conditions can be assured that the treatment which they receive within the NHS is evidence-based, audited and likely to produce a good result, while keeping to a minimum the possibility of an adverse effect. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wilkie. I'll open up by just making a couple of comments. I was not the convener of the committee when this petition first came forward, but I know from talking to colleagues both on the committee and those who have shown an interest in this situation since it was brought to our attention, that this has been, if not the most distressing, certainly amongst the most distressing issues that the committee has heard. I'd like to put on record my thanks to Elaine Holmes and all of McIlroy for bringing such an important matter to the attention of the Scottish Parliament. I think it's been vital that that has been done. And I'd like to thank you for the work that you've started to undertake. I know you've not completed it, but I think it's certainly allowed us to keep the foot on the gas, if you like, in terms of taking this issue forward. So I'm going to open it up to committee members to ask questions a bit more, but just because I'm new to this, I'm trying to get a bit of context around this. I think the figure that you've given is that one in five women affected by this process have had difficulties of one form or another with the process. How many other procedures that are taking place in the medical field at the moment would have such a large number of people adversely affected and would be allowed to be undertaken as a matter of course?
I find that quite difficult to answer because of such the wide range of it. I'm not sure that I can answer, and I apologise. And also, it sounds as if you're putting off, but it depends on what you define as complications, whether it's minor complications or serious complications. I don't know if, Rachael, you want to add anything to that. I'm not aware, and perhaps you might want to direct that more at the Chief Medical Officer when she comes along. I'm not aware of something that would allow me to say, well, that's the cut-off point for such and such. It depends on the severity of the condition, the you know, how it's impacting, what the type of the procedure is, where it's done, how it's done. I'm not sure, I don't know if you could help on that, whether there's an answer. I apologise for
that's fine.
That.
Yeah, if you don't have the answer,
Yes, well, again, I think it is a very difficult question to answer. I think what I would say is that, you know, as doctors, we would definitely recognise that no surgical procedure is without risk. It's always difficult decisions around balancing the likely benefits and the known risks that occur from any given procedure. And procedures develop, you're always on shifting sands, if you like, because there's always innovation in medical practice. And it is really important that we understand, as new medical devices come in, what the associated balance of risks and benefits are.
Okay, that's a reasonable answer, yeah. David and then Jackson.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, everybody. Conclusion 4 of your report identifies gaps in research and in information collected by the NHS. Could you comment on any difficulties the review faced in reaching its conclusion as a result of these gaps?
As I said, we are lucky, I think, in Scotland in having good information, but as usual, it's routine data and we're relying on it, and I'll let Rachael comment on that. But I think we are lucky in having the data sets that we do, the information, the numbers, as it were, and the ability to link data and to look at that. So that, I think, gave us quite an advantage in looking at that. The research data, the main gap we found, I think, or two gaps, really, the main gap we found is in research going into the longer term. And so... you would find research and looking at it, and I'll let Phil comment further, and it would be, you know, 1-2 years. But some of our patients reporting these complications coming further down. So that is, if that's what you, that caused problems of having research body that looked on the longer term. And therefore, the information that ISD and Rachael was able to look at has got a longer term. So that helped match that. But really, the main thing about the research were those things about longer term follow-up, including routine surveillance, longer term follow-up, and also looking at not just, if I could put it, a clinical outcome, you know, the operation mark, say, but also the impact on quality of life. And also, you know, how is this impacted on how people go about their daily life? You know, can they go about their daily life or how? So those sort of things. I don't know, in terms of the research, Phil, do you want to add anything to that?
Yes, I'm happy to just pick up two points which you haven't discussed, Lesley. The first is that many of the studies which are undertaken are looking very clearly at a precise clinical procedure. And a one-year or two-year follow-up for surgical complications is not an unusual practice in many of the randomised control trials and other what we call well-constructed trials, which look at the procedure of interest against the alternative current practice, which is a fairly common research approach. Two-year follow-up is common within the material. Five-year follow-up is not impossible, but it requires quite a considerable research follow-up time and also a service follow-up time within the NHS. And as a consequence of that, the recommendation is looking very clearly at how audit may be a way in which we can look at those longer-term follow-ups. The second thing to say is many of the ladies who have had experiences which are adverse discuss it in terms of their everyday life, rather than formal indicators of quality of life. There is a tendency within the research literature to look at those formal indicators of quality of life, which are somewhat abstracted from the type of day-to-day lives that we all lead. And we recognise that that is a major gap in understanding people's lived experience, that the surgery may well give consequences into the types of day-to-day activities that we accept as straightforward. Dressing, bathing, being able to get out of the house when they choose to rather than when it's arranged for them, as opposed to an indicator of, for example, within one called the SF 36, whether or not we feel happy. The types of indicators of interest to people aren't necessarily the indicators we were finding within the systematic reviews. I think Rachael will probably want to pick up on the longer-term data availability, because I think putting that material side by side with what we saw in the systematic reviews actually provides a very strong clarity in answering your question.
So I could make some comments on the routine data that's available within NHS Scotland to help monitor the safety of any type of medical care, including these operations. So what we did, my analysis was based mainly on routine hospital discharge records, and any operation that a patient receives in hospital is recorded in those national records using an agreed coding system. So they have a code rather than a description of what was done. And one issue that we came across was there can be, in some cases, a considerable lag between an operation becoming available and actually a specific code that describes that operation becoming available. So in that interim period, provision of those operations are difficult to identify using the national data. So, for example, even now, there is no code to record the provision of mini slings, which is a newer type of tape procedure for incontinence. So ISD has specifically asked the Health and Social Care Information Centre in England, who maintains that coding system, to develop, to create a code for mini slings. So at the moment, we're still in the situation where we can't say how many women are having mini slings. So that's one issue we came across, which is a very practical issue. The second issue, I think, so that's about identifying the actual operations that women are having. There are also issues around capturing adverse outcomes that happen after that. And again, sometimes that relates to the availability of specific codes as well. So, for example, There are specific codes available for the removal of tapes, but there are no codes currently available for the removal of prolapse mesh. So again, we've requested that those codes are created. It's not, I want to be clear that it's not that these things can't be recorded. They can be recorded, but they at the moment, they have to be recorded using relatively non-specific codes because there isn't an absolutely specific code available. So that causes some issues. The other issue, I think, when you're using routine data to look at problems women have after operations is we only were able to look at problems that were severe enough for women to be readmitted into hospital. So they had a hospital discharge record. A lot of other women will have had possibly less serious problems that have been managed in an outpatient setting or by their GP, or perhaps they never even brought those problems to the attention of a doctor at all. And those we will not have been able to look at. There is information about care provided in outpatients, but it's less detailed than information on inpatient care. So that is those are other issues. I hope that answers your question.
Jackson.
Thank you, Convener. Can I begin also by congratulating Elaine Holmes and all of McIlroy on the work that they did bringing this petition to us. I see Marion Scott in the gallery from the Sunday Mail, and I think obviously she has been a tower of strength in ensuring these issues came to us. I'd also like to welcome you, Dr. Wilkie. We've heard a lot about you, but this is the first time the committee's actually had an opportunity to meet you. And I'd like to thank you for your report. I'm quite proud, in fact, that it is Scotland that has produced what seems to me to be the first piece of qualitative research on this whole subject. It comes up with a lot of quite robust conclusions, some of which, frankly, will be for the Cabinet Secretary to respond to shortly in terms of what she intends to happen to them, because unless they're implemented, then, in fact, nothing changes. So the importance is really in how they're taken forward. But there are a couple of things that I picked out reading through it, and they're kind of flavour things, and I just wanted your reaction. The first is, have we truly overcome the prejudice that seemed to exist within clinicians against the women who were reporting these issues? I mean, I notice in the testimonies to which you refer that in the positive statements on page 19 even, I have been advised by my gynecologist that fitting women with tapes to support their bladder has been suspended due to a tiny amount of problems. And I immediately arrested on this, which was meant to be one of the positive testimonies coming forward, as one, A, which looked as if it had been solicited rather than volunteered, and secondly, had been solicited in rather a prejudicial manner. And it left me with the residual impression that notwithstanding what I think is the report you produced, which identified concerns which your committee has endorsed, out there, there may still be a broader sense that, I'm sorry to put it like this, that there are some sort of silly hypochondriacal women who don't seem to understand that they were very lucky to have this operation in the first place. Now, have we overcome that prejudice?
Well, we can't have overcome it from this report because this is a report. However, we did feel quite strongly, and I personally feel quite strongly, there is an issue of listening to women here, valuing. I don't know, I'm a woman, and you wonder, anyway, I won't comment, but I'll not go there. But there is this issue about that. I don't think we didn't look into that and exactly what, we didn't go out and look at that particularly. But as you say, the patient views come across strongly that they weren't listened to. I was very seized by that, that they went through a phase of not being listened to. And so that's why we put in the recommendation about education and this idea. It's not just education is obviously not just about knowledge of the side effects, and which, of course, it is a balance. And in terms of how many and what percentage, the majority are not reporting poor outcomes, But there is this significant one with really poor outcomes. So that knowledge and the knowledge that that's there has to be there. But it's not just a case about knowledge and education, as you were aware. It's about that empathy, that appreciation, that ability to listen and actively listen, and also to have the woman involved in that. And I think the work that has been done, excuse me, not until I wasn't involved at all, by the previous working group, now an expert group, on consent, with members behind me on that, with Elaine and Olive, etc., on that and looking at that. So now out there for stress urinary incontinence is this a much more detailed informed consent, so that consent truly is informed for the procedure. But then there is this issue of people coming back with complaints and being listened to. So I think there is this educational thing out there. And that is something that we do, although it's in there as a recommendation, but it is quite a wide-ranging thing. So no, it hasn't happened already. But I think among the clinicians, I think the clinicians we've had on the group have talked about really, you know, it's been a revelation for them as well. But obviously they're dealing with it for a day-to-day. We're talking about the wider community.
I suppose partly my concern is, and we may hear from the Cabinet Secretary that she intends to accept the recommendations, and I then am immediately struck, will there be a body of people, clinicians, who are then trying to have these recommendations set aside before the final report is published, in the sense that they feel that, well, we don't agree with that, now that it's been set up as being a recommendation, we want to try and test that and overturn it. Because we, you know, that's not been our experience, and that's not what we want to do or agree with.
I don't really. I mean, I certainly from the clinicians that I've spoken to. No, I have to say. I mean, I am no longer a practicing doctor, which is, I'm retired now. But the clinicians I've spoken to are committed to a good outcome. I mean, I don't have that cynicism about people, I'm afraid. And I'm trying to think, is it because of, you know, where I am? But I don't have that cynicism.
Well, I mean, only...
But I am aware of this problem that's highlighted.
Right.
And I think I don't get the impression from the clinicians, certainly the clinicians on the group, and they've got a selling business. And we did have the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecology on the group, the specialist associations for both urologists and gynecologists right. on the group. So they're okay. leading professional organisations.
I suppose,
but that's not to say that I think they're, you know.
Yeah. It's only because some, I think, sought to challenge the moratorium itself.
Indeed.
Which leaves me just, you know,
indeed.
Wondering.
I can understand where you're coming
right.
from.
I mean, I think you have touched on the research. I mean, I am struck in the systematic review, chapter 5.5, page 51. No long-term adverse outcomes were considered. No long-term adverse outcomes were considered.
Indeed.
No long-term adverse outcomes were considered. No trials included in the systemic review. No long-term adverse outcome data were reported. That, I mean, one of the key recommendations out of this, which is the advising of adverse incidents, really has to be something which is put in place not just in the weeks after the operation takes place, but for a much longer period of time if we are going to truly continue to monitor it beyond this initial report. I mean, that is what you would be looking for, is it?
Yeah, it's true surveillance. And I think embedding it in the... That is the idea behind, and of course the expert group will develop this, of having an information system.
Right.
And to really look at how adverse events are reported, recorded. I think there's a body of work there to be done separate from the review
okay.
as to how what is the most effective way to ensure that happens.
And one final question, convener, if it's all right. One of the things that was exempt from the suspension were the Sims trials. And that does include what you identify elsewhere and here as a concerning procedure. What is your view then about women in Scotland continuing to be allowed to participate in trials which include a procedure which you regard as concerning? Is that really acceptable on the back of this interim report?
I don't think on the basis of this report or in my own experience, I have got the ability to comment on that. I think that, but issues such as that and the use of this procedure is really why we felt we had done a considerable body of work in the interim review. We brought this quickly. We are keen for the expert group to set up. We're keen for the Cabinet Secretary's response to that, because in a strict term, we used... There is this sort of... the numbers evidence, the information, there's the research evidence, which does not, if you read it, it does not give a clear yay, nay, really. So we decided to put on top of that the considerable body of evidence from the women's experience, good and bad, and also from the clinician's expert opinion. What does this mean in practice? And then we came up with those recommendations expressing concern. I think now the expert group has to take that forward and see what does that mean for practice in Scotland just now, and I suppose including research practice. I think...
understand my concern.
I mean, see what you say.
Obviously, I mean, if it is a loophole through which recommendations that might be even accepted within the overall report, if participating in a trial allows people to circumvent what is a recommendation, that would be unfortunate.
It's something I have got no knowledge of. Rachael, do you want to?
Maybe I could make some comments on that. As I understand, I'm not directly involved in the Sims trial at all, but as I understand it, it's looking at the relative effectiveness of the newer mini slings, the single incision tapes for incontinence, and the standard retropubic tapes. Now, you say the report indicates some concern about mini slings. I assume that's what you're referring to, and there is indeed a Cochrane review that does indicate some concern about that. But the Cochrane review, almost all the trials in that review relate to the very first type of mini sling, which has now actually been withdrawn from the market. So these are newer versions of mini slings, and there is genuine uncertainty as to whether they may, you know, there are theoretical reasons for thinking they may well be superior to some of the standard tapes. There is genuine uncertainty, and therefore it's reasonable to do that trial. And no trial would be approved unless without careful consideration of the ethical issues involved.
Okay, I mean, I'm not entirely convinced, I have to say that. But fair enough.
Okay, John Wilson, followed by Neil.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Can I say that I welcome the interim report, because I think we have moved a long way from when the petition was first put before this committee, from a situation where women felt they weren't being listened to actually seeing an interim report that actually takes account of many of the women's experiences that they face. But there are still questions that arise regarding the interim report in relation to some of the conclusions and some of the issues that are raised in the report. And I'd like to start off by asking about the evidence. You said that there's very little statistical evidence to highlight the long-term impact on women that women face, because what you've said is the issues relate to the experiences of women still talk about a minority of women, but at the same time you admit there is not enough data being collected on the experiences, and you gave, as Jackson Carlo indicated, some positive examples of where women feel they've had a positive experience of this procedure. But in reality, we don't have the whole picture. We don't have the experience of every person that went through this procedure. And what we were told as a committee previously is that some of that data was not only not collected, but did not have to be collected by clinicians. In terms of the recommendations before us, I note that you've said that you want that data collected and you want better monitoring. How can we be guaranteed that that will take place and ensure that we do get not just the short-term impact, but the longer-term, because the comments have been made about the quality of life and the day-to-day experience, but there's also the issue about the long-term impact that may not be noticeable immediately in relation to an adverse effect, but it may be a few years later, 5 years, 10 years down the road, there is an adverse effect. How do we ensure that that data is collected?
I'll turn to Rachael, because we do have, as I said before, the database in Scotland, so we do have longer-term in the IASD data. And I think that is one of our main recommendations that that I would hope for a response on, that we do have that long term. Richard, do you want to say something about the long term nature or not of what you've looked at already?
Well, it is. I find this quite a difficult issue because it is a balance, and any monitoring needs to be, to some extent, proportionate. Otherwise, you know, it would place a really heavy financial strain, if nothing else. So you need to have sufficient monitoring to be very clear that you can pick up any serious safety concerns without completely paralysing the system. So it's not true to say that we have no information in Scotland. We do have information. ISD is a very important part of the whole NHS in Scotland, I think. And we do... We have had and will continue to get records from every inpatient admission, every new outpatient attendance, and so on. But those records, they inevitably, because they are high-level national records, they inevitably only contain quite a low level of detail. So they don't tell you things like how the woman feels and the quality of life that that woman is experiencing. So I think it's a question of making sure that the routine data that the NHS holds is as robust and relevant and as well used as possible, and seeing if that needs supplemented with anything else. And that something else might be one-off research trials or qualitative work, and it may be some other forms of non-routine information gathering as well. So I think there is great potential value in some of the professional databases that surgeons are encouraged to participate in, and we know they're not used as well as they could be.
Stop there, Dr. Wood. They said that surgeons are encouraged to use.
Yes.
And that was part of the problem when
absolutely
the petitioners came to us, is that surgeons and clinicians were not recording the experiences of the women, and the women felt they were being, their experiences were being ignored, therefore the issues were not being addressed, and they felt that they were being devalued in some way because the clinicians and the surgeons were not prepared to gather that data and record that data. So can we be assured, not making suggestions or recommendations to surgeons, but can we find a way of actually ensuring that surgeons and clinicians do record where there is a recognised adverse effect in relation to the procedures that are being carried out in women?
I think that's the basis. I mean, probably those are questions you might want to address in the next session as well. Mm-hmm. But as far as our recommendations are concerned, there was two looking at that. One was looking at the need for an information resource to enable them to do that, so in an organised fashion, and to enable comparisons to happen, as Rachael has said, at a national level and a local level, to organise into multidisciplinary teams and groups, and also to, there is a clinicians, I think it's, there are, clinicians are committed, I agree it's not universal, but we heard of databases that the professional bodies, as Rachael has mentioned, that would contain that. The trouble is they're standalone. They aren't able to get the richness. So the recommendation we've made is for IST to work with these professional bodies where they have a database to see if we can. So I think, so that's about having the data. And yes, there are professional, there are some very committed clinicians who are collecting this data. Around it. You say about the issue about how can we ensure, again, I don't think that's within my gift, but what we do say is that there is an appraisal system, there's a statutory revalidation system now for medical staff, which is based on enhanced appraisal. That looks at patient outcomes, usually, and there has to be evidence for that. So all of these things, all of these recommendations didn't just come out of the blue. These are based on that as something as building blocks towards assuring that. Again, decisions on how far that goes, as Rachael said, is not for us in the review. That is for the decision makers in terms of how, you know, resource committed to it.
Right. thank you for that response, but the reality is, as you, in your gift as the chair of this working group, to actually strongly recommend the way forward in relation to how surgeons, clinicians and others deal with the reporting mechanisms. And it, you're quite right, it's then up to the government how they decide to take that Thank forward, you. How they fund that. But it would be useful in terms of the recommendations. There's a strong emphasis in terms of the collecting of that data, and not just about encouraging surgeons and clinicians from recording, but effectively mandating surgeons and clinicians to collect that information so that we are clear about the evidence that's being gathered.
I think we felt that as part of the appraisal force that was equivalent to mandating, but yeah. I take on board what you say and keep it in mind for the final report. Thank you for that comment.
Can I go back to the group members, because I sat in this committee a number of months ago and we heard evidence from representatives of MHRA who virtually dismissed the concerns of the women in relation to the procedures, and I would say dismissed the any impact that the devices were having on women's lives. Can I take it that all the review group members are signed up to this interim report and to the recommendations that are currently contained within it?
Yes, we've had no adverse, the report was circulated in many drafts. I would say that I felt that if you're saying is MHRA signed up, yes, they have not indicated not being signed up, they are signed up to it. I think, again, you know, members of the Scottish Mass Survivor Group were very clear that they wanted all of those things in place, the criteria we put down before the commencement. So in terms of, and I think it says that in the report, so, but no, if you're asking specifically MHRA, yes, they are signed up.
Right. Thank you very much for that. And finally, convener, just to ask, you've indicated in your opening of the executive summary, you're still waiting on the opinion of the European Commission and its Scientific Committee on Emerging and Newly Identified Health Risks opinion. Has this interim report been sent to the European Commission? Because my experience in the past, the commissioners are keen to hear the reports from parliaments in Europe. And given the significance of this interim report on the devices being used, then it might help influence the outcome of any decisions that are being made within the European Commission, particularly their scientific review body.
I should think, remember, I would think they have done, but I will check with the Secretariat. Of interest is that we have had response from the professional, international professional organisation of urogynecologists. So they've had that internationally. So there is international interest in it. So I'd be really quite surprised if it hasn't been. So, but if not, I will ensure it does.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener.
Okay, Neil.
I know people have congratulated the women who brought this forward. I don't congratulate them. I sympathise and I empathise with them. They should never have had to go through this torturous, physically and emotionally torturous process to get to this stage. And the only reason they did have to do that is because there was a willingness amongst the medical profession to believe those people who said mesh was a success and an unwillingness to believe those who said it wasn't. And that's the issue that has got us to where we are today. I just want to pick up the first point on a couple of the issues that Dr. Wood raised. She mentioned the difficulty of getting a code. Now, that to me seems incredible. Could you explain, you know, why it takes so long to get a code? If Tesco gets a new brand of beans in, they'll code it in 5 minutes and it'll be on sale. Now, I know we're not dealing with human beings here, we're not dealing with beans, but how on earth does it take such a long time for someone, somewhere, to come up with a code?
Well, I think it's a valid question, and I can't... It's not within my gift. I'm not the person that decides whether new codes are agreed or not. The codes for operations is the Office of Population Census and Surveys system, and that is maintained now by the Health and Social Care Information Centre in England. The coding system we use for patients' diagnoses is the International Classification of Diseases, and that is maintained by the World Health Organization. So that's even more complex because that's a global system. So there is a, for either of those coding systems, there is a process where any interested party can submit a request to have a new code generated. There is value. These coding systems are used for international comparisons, and there is a value in having them reasonably stable over time. Otherwise, it's just chaos, and you can't do the kind of analyses that we're doing. So I think it is reasonable that a very controlled process is required to agree new codes. It is quite a lengthy process, and I can't comment on why it's lengthy, really. You'd have to ask the Health and Social Care Information Centre about that. But I think one of... yes, maybe I should stop there, and you can come back.
I understand it's not your responsibility. In terms of the data, when we met with the previous Cabinet Secretary 2 years back, I had asked parliamentary questions asking how many adverse incidents had been reported. And the answer we got was 6. And at that meeting, the women round the table said, well, that must be us then. Now, so since then, through consistent freedom of information requests, various methods of data gathering, we now find out that it's at least hundreds, and I would probably guess we're probably over that, probably into thousands. So therefore, how can we provide information to women who have been affected by this if we don't know how many there are and where they are and where they live? How do we alert them to the problem? And secondly, on that point, shouldn't we be just be doing that? That surely if someone has something that has been described, what's the term we're using, concerning, in their body, then if that was me, I would certainly want to know. So why is the recommendation not that everyone who has been implanted and we know where they are, being alerted that there is a potential concern here?
How do we alert them and how do we make sure that that's the thing? I think the whole informed consent is important. The informed consent leaflet, which has been and process actually, which has been developed by the working group and the expert group with involvement of patients, is probably one of the most extensive works in surgery, I would imagine, of informed consent, of taking into account of all the... So when a woman goes forward with stress urinary incontinence, of being aware, or with pelvic organ prolapse, of being aware of all that, I think that's very important. And I think the work that's been done in that group, nothing to do at all with us round the table, that is really quite leading in this. There's a lot of information. And I think for that... Again, it's not always about provision of information. It's not always just about giving information. It's about people having the time to assimilate that, to be assisted, and people who have, difficulties in assimilating written information. So there's a whole process around it, and I think that's what needs to be put in place, not just the written information. So I think informed consent. I think where we say we've got concerns, all we have about is looking forward. What we have to be aware of is that no regulatory body in the world has withdrawn, done anything about these. So in looking at Phil can mention, and the evidence there of looking across all the evidence, we haven't found any... Some of them have said reassessment. I think there's one Phil can comment on this, reassessment. But the evidence, the actual written evidence is there. The regulatory body for Scotland as well as the UK is MHRA, so I think that's the body that would be looking at that. So I can't comment about that. I'm just saying looking forward, and we're looking at forward in improving patient care, that based on the information we've got, based on the evidence from the patients, clinicians, and somewhat of the evidence of that we've got from these two strands, that these are of concern and that they need to be looked at, not never, but need to be looked at in the concern, the context, those two procedures, not mesh, those two procedures, there's two ways of doing it. And that's specifically what our recommendation says, because we felt that we had the evidence for that. I don't know if that answers.
I'm afraid you've said a lot of words there that I don't particularly understand and don't come to a conclusion. What I'm asking is, given what we know, should we not be writing to women and saying, there may be a problem here? I think people have the right to be alerted to the fact that they may have something in their body that is defective. I'm not finished there.
Oh, sorry.
Could I ask you personally, and you know, if you were a male, I wouldn't be asking you this, right? But if you had gone through this procedure and there was these concerns, wouldn't you want to know?
I think my gender is irrelevant. I will say, I see where you're coming from, and I don't have the evidence to say. What I was trying to say is I haven't got the evidence in the report to say that, nor would it be the business of this review to say that.
Okay, John Scott.
Thank you, convener. And I, too, welcome this preliminary report. However, taking the combined totals of operations on pages 25 and 23 of it, and I'm not certain from my lay perspective how many of those operations required mesh implants, I am nonetheless concerned about the size of the study, which seems to deal in the low hundreds of people. When you add up these numbers of operations, they're somewhere approaching 30,000. And yet we're dealing here in terms of a report in a very low numbers of hundreds of people. So I think this probably is a welcome piece of work as a first step, but I think there is still a huge amount of work to establish the scale of the problem and hopefully reassure ourselves that very few people have been affected by this, but that it's a major concern of mine that there may be many, many more people, women affected by this than this study somehow suggests. But perhaps I'm getting the wrong end of the stick and be happy to be corrected by you in that regard, if indeed I am.
So maybe I can hopefully clarify some of those issues. So the study that you're referring to specifically, that's the work that I did in ISD using the national routine hospital discharge data. So this is a complete population-based study. Unlike a trial, it's not a selected group of women. We looked at all women in Scotland who'd had these procedures. Now, in terms of the numbers of women having tape procedures for incontinence, actually very high. And we've got a lot of women there because that has been the dominant procedure for stress incontinence for some years.
Some figures, even the ballpark.
Well, on page 23.
Yes. Yes.
So if you look, we can. The tape procedures are the last three.
Yes.
There. So you can see that in recent years,
about
the absolutely
000,
vast majority of procedures being done have been tape procedures.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say our study didn't quite capture all the operations that are going on because we did look at all women, but then we focused on women that were having single procedures and women that hadn't had an operation in the past. Because sometimes women have multiple operations at the same time and sometimes they're coming back for repeat. And if we included them, it was difficult to see what had caused any adverse outcomes. So this isn't the absolute totality, but it's quite a high proportion of these operations. Then if you look on page 25, that shows the numbers of women having prolapse operations. So it is true that the mesh, if you look just at the first two lines, the anterior repairs for anterior prolapse, standard repairs without mesh are much more common than mesh repairs. So mesh repairs have never been used in large numbers in Scotland for that particular issue. And the same is true for posterior repairs. And then we get into slightly more complex. The last four lines are operations for prolapse of the top of the vagina or the uterus. So the incontinence and the prolapse are quite different. But this is the totality of women. And compared to a clinical trial, these are quite high numbers. Even the anterior and posterior mesh repairs, I accept that we're into 200-400 women included in our study, but it's quite a high number compared to the numbers that would be included in a clinical trial. And I think it does give us quite a robust idea of the proportion of women in the real world, in normal care in NHS Scotland. This isn't a trial, this is just what's happening in the NHS. The proportion of those women coming back up to 5 years after their operation. So, and I think there is a clear signal. So even though we've got quite a small number of women having mesh anterior or posterior repair, it's very clear that the risk of coming back for complications in the subsequent 5 years is considerably higher for those women than it is for women coming back with a non-mesh repair.
I would also say, is it not possible to go back a great deal further than 5 years? I myself have recently been invited to take part in a trial going back to an accident I had some 18 years ago, in a neurological sense. And I just wonder if it isn't possible to go back further than the short time scales it appears that you're dealing with, relatively speaking.
I think the short answer is no, it's not possible for this particular condition. Because they were only introduced, tapes were introduced around 2000, 2001, 2002, and we've captured all those. The mesh anterior and posterior repairs really only came in the mid-2000s. So there's a limit to how long, you know, obviously over time we'll be able to look at that group of women and say how many came back with complications over 10 and 15 years. But because they're relatively recently introduced procedures, a five-year follow-up is really all we can do now to get a reasonable number of women in the study.
So, see, how long do records go back, or how long are records available within
the ISD NHS? Has routine hospital discharge records are available for decades. They go back to the 60s and 70s. They've become a bit more tricky to analyse, the very old ones, but certainly into the early 80s is not a problem for us to analyse, but these operations weren't being done at that time.
Thanks so much.
Okay. One final question from myself, if you don't mind. We've heard a lot about the comparison between Scotland and elsewhere, and it appears as though, in terms of analysing this situation, we're further ahead than most other countries, and that's to be welcomed. I think that's because we've had this petition, and the review was asked to look for that data. But the data is incomplete by your own admission. You're looking for information, you're trying to complete the information that's available. But my recollection of the response around this petition initially, from the Scottish Government, was that there should be a suspension of this process while the work is undertaken. Now, subsequent to that, it appeared that there hasn't been a suspension. If I heard the word moratorium held earlier. There hasn't actually been a moratorium because, as far as I understand, these procedures have continued to be undertaken. Is that correct?
My understanding is that they've reduced remarkably, but still some procedures took place. I think you might have to direct that again to Cabinet Secretary. My understanding is, we were under the impression there was a suspension, I think, when we started the review, but that some were taking place in the context of clinical trials. I wasn't directly involved in that. Our understanding was that. There is a suspension because, as one member said, the clinicians want to start doing it, and women with the condition that have been through the informed consent want it to start. Therefore, it's not happening. But the statistics would show that very much less, that there is still some taking place. Could I return to another point? It's Mr. Finlay's point, because I don't think I answered your question at all.
And
that concerns me. I think Rachael sort of scrimmaged. I think you were asking me, should we recall people who've had the retropubic approach?
Should
or
we
the
be advising?
Yeah, I think what my feeling with that, I don't know, because the ins and outs of recall is a procedure that is up to the powers that be, as it were. But actually having good information with women's GPs and that they know. So I think it's sort of what I would hope would be, if you're asking me personally, and me personally, would hope that this idea that it's okay to say that that you've got self-confidence as a woman to say, actually, I did have this procedure, and what I'm feeling is true. And if you're asking how I would do, I would hope I would have that, and not women can, that go along and say, I've had this, I'm getting these symptoms, I think it's due to the mesh, and here we are, it's something saying this is a procedure that maybe nowadays that is recommended that should only be in exceptional circumstances. So that, the recall, I would leave to somebody else as to whether that's necessary. I don't know. I haven't got enough knowledge if that's the best way.
Can I say that? That's what you would do as a woman in your mind and your body.
Yes.
Another woman, exactly, not with your personality or your confidence,
absolutely,
might sit at home terrified and be, yep, completely oblivious,
yeah,
to what the causes of her problems would,
yeah,
be, because,
yeah,
she doesn't give a hoot what the Scottish Parliament does or the Petitions,
yeah,
Committee in the Scottish Parliament looks at, and doesn't read the Sunday Mail, and, mm, and doesn't listen, mm, to politicians. That's the person and the people,
yeah,
that I'm more concerned about. How do we get the information to them? And can I ask one final point,
yeah,
while I've got the opportunity?
No, sorry, Chairman.
You've got the minority report has been produced by some of the members of the committee. Have you seen the minority report and will you be commenting on it?
I'm aware, I haven't seen the minority report, no.
We'll get you a copy.
And I'm aware of the concern. I think that's what I was trying to allude to when you asked a question actually about the MHRA, and I'm knowing that there is concern, so that's why I answered that. So I know there is, and I'd hoped that we'd phrased the report saying that all these things have to be in place before. So, yes, so in a way, I think I know what was in it. I'd be grateful for a copy, but that's why I was trying to answer that. And so I take your concern about the other thing. I see what you're saying. I think it's not a problem. And maybe it's something that has to be thought of as to how we ensure that.
Yeah, OK, Jackson,
sorry,
one more.
Sorry, convener.
I just wanted to follow up something with Dr. Wood, because it was in response to, yeah, John Wilson's earlier evidence when we were talking about the potential of contacting all women. And I think I heard you say something like there has to be a balance struck, there would be a cost involved and all of that. And I'm trying to understand what I'm striking the balance with, because in the discussion you then had with Mr. Scott, in the grand scheme of things, it doesn't seem to me that the number of women involved represents such a huge body that it wouldn't be possible to have a more proactive strategy of ongoing contact with these women and monitoring their performance going forward. Because, I mean, we're talking at a number somewhere in mesh, I think, of between the overall number of operations of, I think Mr. Scott said, about 30,000, and the mesh ones being about half of that potentially. And that, I mean, to me sitting here, that doesn't sound like such a huge or impossible or financially onerous responsibility for the health service to proactively contact women and also to return to those women at later intervals when we are concerned that a successful experience now might have complications that arise at a later date.
So maybe I could try and clarify what I was trying to say. I work in ISD, so I'm primarily interested in the routine data that the NHS collects on all patients all the time. And that, I think that's where I was trying to express a desire for proportionality. I don't think it's a sensible suggestion to say that we should massively expand the routine hospital discharge records to collect extensive information about how women feel and their quality of life, because that, I don't think it's the appropriate way to do that. So I think there is a sense of proportionality of what routine data should the NHS collect all the time on everybody, so that we can do these kind of analysis when the next issue comes up on another aspect of medical care. There are then separate questions, I think, about what specifically should be done about this type of mesh surgery. And I think that it's a different issue. I think there, and
in that particular case, there are some general lessons for the national data from this work. So there are some things like having more precise information on the type of device that's been implanted in a woman, and it probably is a good idea if that were collected in the routine data. So that's one issue, but then there probably does need to be something additional specifically for mesh, and I don't dispute that at all. It's possibly not primarily ISD's job to do that. So I think I was trying to reflect my views on the national data that needs to be there for all patients all the time.
So there may be a job of work to be done. That may be something we need to put to the Cabinet Secretary, but it's not necessarily falling into your particular sphere of research collection.
It's a balance of what can we learn about the routine data, the actual what's in the data, what's collected, how it's analysed, how we direct our energies into how we analyse those data, but what complementary activities would be beneficial specifically about mesh. That may be some kind of national audit or the professional databases, and ISD would be involved in that, but that's not solely within our gift. I hope that gives you an idea of what I was talking about.
That's
balance.
Helpful. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Dr. Rogge.
That in other conditions there have been such national audits which are going to more extensive detail. My colleague here was reminding me a bit on hip fracture, for example, where more extensive information is put in place. And I think what's known and referred to in the report is the BSUG database, which is the professional database, which acknowledged, you know, not every surgeon before somebody says is that, but it is a more extensive database. And so there are examples where audits rather than routine data where the information is input but in a routine fashion but not by ISD would give more detailed clinical and lifestyle information.
Okay, I was leading up to a final question a wee while ago and we got into another discussion, but it wasn't unhelpful because it actually helps to make the point that I was leading up to, which is about the incompleteness of the data. And the word that you used repeatedly, and Dr. Wood used it just as she was concluding her last comments, was about this balance being struck, about a need for balance. Given that there is such incomplete data, given the level of concerns that we've heard around the implications of this procedure being conducted, given that we thought that there was a suspension in place, which might not actually be a suspension, given that there are still procedures being undertaken as part of clinical trials. Were you asked on balance to consider adapting the precautionary principle, which says until we know more about this, we should not be doing this?
No, we weren't asked that specifically. And our remit was to find the information and to look at that and to see. So in terms of whether it should be suspended or not, that was not part of our remit. It was looking at what information we've got to enable that. So in terms of, you know, was that part of our remit, and certainly not in the interim report, we weren't asked that.
Okay, that's helpful in terms of what we might have to ask the Cabinet Secretary, but on behalf of the committee, can I thank you for your contributions this morning. Again, we'll probably have you coming back when your work is more complete, but in the meantime, thank you very much for what you've given us this morning, and I'll suspend the committee for a few minutes to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Okay, thanks everyone. I'll reopen the meeting again because we're continuing with our evidence on the mesh medical devices, and I now welcome Shona Robson, the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport, to our meeting. The Cabinet Secretary is accompanied today by Catherine Calderwood, the Chief Medical Officer for the Scottish Government. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short statement before we go to questions. Over to you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you.
Good morning, Convener. Thank you. And thanks to the committee for providing me with an opportunity this morning to respond to the interim report of the independent review of transvaginal mesh implants. I think we certainly all appreciate how harrowing this has been for the women concerned and for their families. I've met with women experience complications and I've read numerous letters and emails expressing their pain and distress. It is deeply concerning to hear the extent of their suffering, and they have my full sympathy. This report has come about as a result of those same women affected bringing this issue to the forefront. It's clear that this is a very emotive subject that has differing views. The report has provided both evidence and informed opinion, helping us understand why there are so many apparently conflicting facts and opinions regarding transvaginal mesh procedures. Regardless of your opinion on this issue, this report will help to improve services to benefit all women suffering these conditions. And I'll say more later on the legacy of those who have brought this issue forward. As you know, I've only recently received the interim report from the independent review, and I want to begin by thanking members for their hard work producing this report. I understand the committee has just heard evidence from the chair of the review this morning. I will set out the Scottish Government's initial response to the conclusions and recommendations, which, while not yet developed in detail, will certainly set out the way forward. This work supports the call for improvements in care by the women in the Scottish Mesh Survivors Group. The review was asked to determine the safety and relative efficacy of mesh implants for stress, urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse. These are two entirely different conditions, and the review has rightly considered them separately. The review has recommended improvements in the management of individual patients, and the Scottish Government agrees. I can confirm that the expert group will continue its work with NHS planners and develop pathways of care for both stress urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse. This will mean developing pathways of care that are firstly consistent with national guidance and delivered by a multidisciplinary team that includes primary care and other relevant community services, and secondly, that surgery is only considered after conservative measures fail. If surgery is needed, then all types of surgery will be considered. We concur that clinicians should provide evidence of involvement in multidisciplinary team working, including an audit of their activity and a record of their reports of adverse events. The expert group will be asked to develop this protocol with a view to medical directors as responsible officers, incorporating this into the clinician's appraisal process. I completely agree that informed consent is a fundamental principle underlying all healthcare and commend the earlier work of the expert group developing the patient information and consent leaflet for SUI. This valuable work will be developed and the leaflet revised to include additional information, including details of the specific implant used. This will mean that if a woman experiences a complication, then she'll have the information required to report an adverse event to the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency. The concept of this leaflet will be extended to POP procedures. The development of care pathways for these conditions will take account of the time needed by a patient to discuss and reflect on the information provided before making a decision. One of the key areas highlighted in the report is the gap in evidence relating to long-term outcome data. The report has recommended that this is addressed through research, and I've therefore asked the expert group to encourage research in this area and discussion with the Chief Scientist Office and other research funders. My predecessor, Alec Neil, asked for an independent review because of growing public concern about the number of women experiencing complications linked with underreporting of adverse events. NHS Information Services Division, ISD, has undertaken a thorough analysis of existing hospital discharge records. This analysis has highlighted the complex decisions clinicians are presented with when treating women with these conditions. The report has distilled this complex information in a way that will help women and clinicians make informed decisions when agreeing a treatment plan. ISD's work has highlighted areas for improvement, and work here has already commenced. This includes work on a UK basis to ensure procedures have codes and implementing these to allow them to be reliably identified in routine data as quickly as possible. Secondly, my officials have already met ISD to consider how to take forward the development of existing information systems in conjunction with other work on the unique device identifier to support active monitoring of these procedures. The expert group will lead on this work stream and will liaise with UK-wide bodies to investigate the feasibility of developing and maintaining a registry. I'm happy to endorse the view that the expert group should review the training and information available to clinical teams and look at ways of incorporating patient views in multidisciplinary team working. I'm pleased to say that a helpline was launched in August, and this has been a welcome addition. Officials are continuing to work with those involved, and posters advertising the helpline are being planned. I'm content to endorse the recommendations on the routine surgical approach where mesh surgery has been agreed subject to the outcome of the final report. I understand the interpretation of available evidence and informed opinion and supports the routine use of the retropubic approach for stress urinary incontinence and any variation considered as part of the multidisciplinary team assessment. The interpretation of the evidence currently available for the use of mesh in pelvic organ prolapse repair has also led to the review concluding that this procedure should only be available in exceptional circumstances, with any variation considered as part of the multidisciplinary team assessment. The independent review awaits the final publication of key research reports before it can publish its final report. And while I'm content that the expert group develops the foundations of these services, as outlined in my preceding statement, I have requested that the services are not introduced until I've received the final report, and I'm satisfied that the improvements have taken account of all of the evidence. We can then work to introduce improved services uniformly across all health boards in Scotland. I want to conclude by thanking Dr. Wilkie and members of the group for their work. It's clear that both the evidence review carried out by the Scottish Public Health Network and the analysis of health data by NHS Information Services Division are thorough and have brought some clarity to what are complex issues. But I also want to say that I understand how incredibly difficult this has been for those involved in the review process, for some highlighting issues that are extremely painful to consider because of their personal experience. I want, therefore, to reiterate my gratitude and hope that they can see the difference that each of them has made. Because they've been prepared to speak publicly of these very sensitive issues and work through the difficulties encountered, women who need this service in the future will benefit from this work. This improvement to services for women experiencing these distressing conditions is their legacy. And I understand that the independent review anticipates publishing its final report early in 2016. Subsequently, the Scottish Government will publish a full response and ensure that the committee is informed of this. Thank you, Convener, for hearing my initial response to this important work.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to open up by asking David Torrance, the Deputy Convener, to ask the first question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Alex Neil, the previous Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing, announced that he would suspend the use of TV mesh in Scotland. Some clinicians still continue to practice. Can you tell me why, and how will the Cabinet Secretary ensure that recommendations of the report and any future recommendations of the expert group are translated into practice by clinicians?
Yep. So let me be clear, first of all, that the numbers of procedures carried out have dropped dramatically, therefore there have been very, very few carried out in the light of the suspension. What I've said, and I've answered this in Parliament on a few occasions now, is that where the woman herself was asking for the procedure because of the distress that her condition was causing, and that the clinician was prepared to continue in that case, then those are the circumstances of which procedures could could go ahead, but they have been very, very small in number. I'll ask Catherine to elaborate on that in a second. In terms of practice by clinicians going forward, I mean, I want to be very, very clear here. The recommendations of the group will be implemented, and they will apply in the same way to every part of Scotland. So Catherine, as the CMO, will ensure that through her work and her guidance that clinicians will be adhering to these new ways of working and and making sure that the recommendations of this report will be taken forward by each and every one of them, and that that will be monitored and appraised. Catherine, do you want to add?
So when the previous CMO wrote to health boards asking them to consider suspending the mesh, there were, of course, women already on waiting lists, so that they were expecting a procedure. What I undertook at that time was to speak individually to clinicians who called in the women from the waiting list to have a conversation with them about the suspension. And at that time, we had already produced a very comprehensive consent form with a lot more detail on it. And that was produced for use in all health boards, so that the women who then subsequently have gone ahead to have the procedures were fully appraised of the risks. They were made aware of the suspension and of the complications that some of the women behind me had brought to light, and so that they were going into those procedures with a lot more information, and also understanding that there were some questions that were going to be looked at in this independent review that had been commissioned. So my understanding is, I think there have been 76 procedures for stress urinary incontinence using mesh, and the prolapse surgery, because of suppression of small numbers, we have to ask individual health boards, the numbers are so small we can't reveal those. So that would make me think that those were numbers less than 10.
Thank you.
Can I just come back on this question then, because it was quite clear to me, I wasn't on this committee at the time, and I was following the issue as most MSPs were, through speaking to colleagues who were more closely involved in the discussions, but also picking up via the media. And it was the Cabinet Secretary at the time who was quite forceful in putting forward a message that there had been a suspension of this procedure. Now, he may have known that it was caveated in terms of doctors being allowed to take forward clinical tests, that some people might be allowed to do it. But do you believe that the message that was given, because I distinctly recall the outcry when it was discovered that these procedures were continuing to take place. So when the Cabinet Secretary at the time said that there was going to be a suspension, people believed that that meant that there would be no more of these procedures. Do you believe that the Cabinet Secretary was clear enough? And do you understand the distress that when it was later discovered that these procedures were continuing, that people felt misled, or that there had been some miscommunication which needed to be addressed?
Well, I mean, I think the first thing just we need to remind ourselves of is that this isn't a banned procedure in terms of under the MHRA. It's a regulatory authority that would ban a procedure in the light of evidence that there was concerns that procedure should not be used. So it's not a banned procedure. So what the Cabinet Secretary did was asked boards to suspend in the light of concerns that had been raised while the expert group was able to do its work in terms of the independent review. However, I wasn't obviously around the detail of this at the time, but looking at the what was said, looking back at what was said, and there was always, I think, the chance and the choice for a woman who was wanting that procedure in the full light of all the information, and as Catherine has explained, the far more robust informed consent procedures, if that woman still wanted to go ahead with the procedure, and given it wasn't a banned procedure, then that would be a clinical decision in liaison with the patient, and that there was scope for that still to go ahead within that set of arrangements, but with full full informed consent and, of course, the level of information that Catherine pointed to earlier on. Now, if there was a communication issue around that and that wasn't clear at the time, then you know, obviously accept that if that was not the perception that some people had, then you know that that is perhaps a communication issue of the time. But I, looking back, I'm pretty clear that that was always there as an option for women, because otherwise you'd be saying to women, even though you know all the informed consent, even though this isn't a banned procedure, we are not going to allow you to have that procedure. And therefore, when I answered those questions, when I became Cabinet Secretary in Parliament, I tried to put the point across that for some women, they may still have chosen to go ahead with that in the full knowledge of all of the potential risks and the full information and, of course, the full knowledge of everything that had been in the press for that women had brought forward. But if, in the light of all of that, women still wanted to go ahead, then the clinician would have that choice.
It might be useful then, Cabinet Secretary, for that as your perception, because I certainly don't recall it. I don't remember those caveats being added to any press statements that came from the Scottish Government. I could be wrong in that. So if you have those press statements, if you have that information, could you send it to the committee? Because I can you can't see this, but I can see the people sitting behind you shaking their heads when you're saying
there was an understanding of the caveats. I didn't say I didn't understand that folk might not have had that perception, and that is a communication issue. But Catherine, do you want to say a little bit about?
I think there was a sentence underneath the Cabinet Secretary's call for a suspension, which talked about a clinical decision in the full light of information, where a woman was approaching a clinician because of severity of symptoms. So there was a phrase which was perhaps not widely reported, but which did allow that clinician and woman interaction.
Maybe you should have made it clearer at the time then. Jackson.
Thank you, convener. Yes, it might have said, would you like to face a firing squad this morning, but some of the soldiers might not have bullets on their guns today.
I don't think we practice medicine like that.
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary, I'm very pleased because I think what you're saying is that you would like this moratorium to remain in place until you're satisfied that the recommendations of the report which you are accepting have been implemented and to a degree that you believe properly reflects their respective importance. I think that's essentially where we're at in the first instance. Mm-hmm. It leads me to three questions. The first really is to say to you, and this is a subjective comment I appreciate, but one of the most deeply unimpressive witnesses this committee heard from was Dr. Maguire of the MHRA, who in his evidence really confirmed what seemed to us to be an underlying impression of the petitioners, that there was a lack of serious regard for the condition which many of them had found themselves in. And in his evidence, in terms of the wider research that had been done, at one stage, rather incredibly to me, it boiled down to three people at some university somewhere and a grant of less than £30,000 who'd spoken to a handful of people 3 years ago. And on the back of that, he was asserting to us that really all was well. I notice he was on the review group, and really, I suppose this is a question for government, and it's something that goes beyond even the scope of this particular incident. But firstly, would you expect the MHRA now in some way to reflect the conclusions of this report, which has validated that there is a concern underlying, which they seemed to be unaware of? And are you satisfied as Cabinet Secretary in a much broader sense that the MHRA, who pled to us that so great was their workload with thousands of things they had to monitor and so few people really had the time to do anything, that actually we have a body in the MHRA which is properly able to respond when an incident of this kind occurs, because so much weight is given to what they say And that was what was so staggering to me, that we were being told the MHRA say there is not a problem, but when we asked the MHRA what they'd done to find out if there was a problem, it was precious little.
So, first of all, I would expect the MHRA absolutely to look at all of the evidence, including what's in this report and what will be in the other reports that are still awaited, and obviously the English report, and there are other reports as well. I would absolutely expect them to look at all of that and any emerging evidence from anywhere else, and that's what they should do. I mean, with regard to the evidence session and what was said, I mean, obviously that's not something that I can say anything other than I get the distinct impression that it wasn't regarded as an evidence session that was particularly helpful. That whether or not they have, I understand some of the issues being raised about the attention that the MHRA are able to give to individual products. I think, given the extent of concern around this issue, I think we would expect the MHRA to give particular attention to it. Now, what I can do in the light of the report, obviously the MHRA are aware of our report, but I certainly, in the light of what you've said and what the committee's views, if they are same as yours, which I'm assuming they would be to make sure the MHRA are well aware of the committee's views as put to me this morning. I'd be happy to do that and to express the concerns that you've expressed this morning to them.
Well, I'd be grateful, because I think the ongoing concern is that another episode in a completely unrelated field could arise, and I think our confidence has slightly been shaken in the underlying research capability of the MHRA and their willingness to make very emphatic statements, which actually this report has suggested might not be the case. I suppose my second question then is relating to the Sims trials. Now, they were subsequent to the moratorium, the suspension, specifically then excluded by the Cabinet Secretary in order that they could continue, but they include, and I imagine they still do, but they include procedures which this report has now identified as being of concern. And so I wonder, therefore, whether you feel in going forward that is appropriate.
Okay, Catherine, do you want to comment on the Sims trial?
So I think that, obviously, having just received this report, you're absolutely correct that we need to go back to that research group. What we would need to look at is whether there is it's feasible to change the protocols of that research, or have there been a number of women recruited already that we would need to go back to. The other option is, of course, that if it's not deemed appropriate, then we don't continue with the research study. I think that's a very important conversation to have with the researchers.
Well, Cabinet Secretary, I'd be grateful if through you and the Chief Medical Officer this committee could be advised. I'm sure Parliament would want to be advised too of the consideration you come to, and I hope that could be an early course.
Yeah, I mean, you'll appreciate we've only just received the interim report, and we're considering, obviously, we've come here this morning with our thoughts to date, but that is something that is, as Catherine said, we'll have to resolve, and we'll do that as quickly as possible, and we'll make sure the committee...
Okay, thank you. And my final question really relates to, now that we have a report that has substantiated the fact that there is a concern, the communication of what we now know to those women who have undergone the procedure, and our recognition really in this report that we don't have long-term data collection in terms of whether or not issues might manifest themselves at a much later point in the process. You've talked about the posters advertising the helpline, but it looks from the report as if we're talking about, to date, somewhere between 15 and 33,000 women across Scotland. And I wonder, should we not, or should the government, or should some official body not actually be much more proactively contacting all women who've had this procedure, Identifying, I admit, that for some of them there will not have been an issue, but making clear to them that for many there are, and that we don't know whether this might not manifest itself at a later stage, and proactively advertising the helpline in that individual communication, so that it's not just a helpline where my mother or my wife might see it advertised when they walk into the GP with a sore throat, but it's actually the women who have had the operation who are being specifically told, and now look, here is a helpline, because I think the concern we have is that there may be women out there who are suffering symptoms who still yet don't realise they are part of a much wider body of people who are, and that it relates in some way to the mesh operation that they had. So I suppose I'm asking, for the number of people involved, might we not see a much more direct, proactive communication strategy detailing the evidence to them in a helpful way, not in a pejorative way, but in a helpful way, and making clear that this helpline does exist, rather than leaving it as something that they fall upon by chance?
I'm certainly happy to look at how we might better communicate with women that have been in that position. I guess we'll have to be quite careful about what that communication says, because obviously we don't want to cause concern among women, but on the other hand, we want to make sure that they have the full information should they require to or need to find, or if the helpline would obviously be a mechanism for them to be able to find out further information. I'll certainly consider that and look at what the options might be.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, John Scott.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just... I'm concerned about the coding system that doesn't appear to work as well as it might. Neil Finlay's already raised this matter. In terms of the further study, could there be an analysis by code? Now, I appreciate some of these operations apparently haven't been allocated a code from a previous lady witness. And therefore, is it possible to retrospectively allocate a code to an operation or a procedure and thereafter conduct an analysis of those procedures and to see if there is one procedure or another that has perhaps caused more grounds for concern? Do you see what I'm trying to say?
I know, I get what you're saying. Obviously, ISD has already started looking at this, and they'll be making sure that procedures are coded more consistently going forward. In terms of retrospectively, I'm not sure whether that could be done or not. I guess we'll have to find out from ISD whether that's possible. If it is, it's something we could certainly look at, but we need to know from them whether that is feasible or not.
It struck me that it might be a way of gathering retrospective information and therefore allowing an analysis subsequently.
Yeah, well, I can see if it can be done, then I think it's definitely something we should look at doing, but I just don't know whether it's feasible, and we've not had that back from ISD yet, because obviously they're really just getting their teeth into this, so we can come back to you on that.
Thanks very much.
Can I just, before going on to the next, because this has caused me a bit of confusion, ISD seemed to be saying that they were waiting on the Scottish Government giving them the go-ahead to do this, and you're saying you have to speak to ISD to see whether you should give them the go-ahead to do this. Somebody needs to make a decision,
no,
your Cabinet Secretary.
We've got no difficulty doing it. It's technically whether it can be done. I mean, if they can do it, they should do it and absolutely get on and do it. What I don't know is whether technically it can be done. There's no issue about should it be done. If it can be done, it should be done. What I don't know is technically whether retrospectively it can be done. It can be done going forward, but whether it can be done retrospectively, as John Scott has asked for, I just don't know the answer. If it can be done, it should be done. Okay. And
thanks. Angus.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Could I go back to the expert group that you were mentioning in your preamble? Just to clarify how quickly the expert group will meet to discuss the report. I mean, clearly, this report just coming out on Friday, it won't have had a chance yet. And how often will it meet? And when it does, will its considerations be made public?
I don't see why not. I think there should be full openness and transparency around the work of the expert group, and it's got important work to do in taking forward the recommendations. We have obviously the final report to receive in the spring of next year, so work will be continuing with that to ensure that we get the final report in the spring. But in terms of its meeting schedule, I mean, the meeting schedule is really down to the expert group itself in terms of how often they have to meet. But given they have a number of tasks, and not just in terms of producing the final report, but in terms of the work going forward, that their meeting schedule will have to reflect that. Catherine, I don't know if you...
So the expert group is already gathered together but has awaited this report, and I think because of the number of recommendations that quite clearly point to work that needs to be done before Cabinet Secretary could be happy that in time for the final report, that some of these recommendations are taken forward in the meantime. So the group is sitting ready, if you like, already has worked together, and I think these recommendations that can be started... work can be started on some of these as soon as that group can get together to meet.
Okay, thanks. And can I look a little at the composition of the expert group? I mean, clearly we heard from the independent review that they had patient representatives on board on the review, and I think everyone welcomed that fact at the time. Are there to be patient representatives on the expert group, and has consideration been given to such representation in the future?
As I understand, there already is.
Yes. Okay.
But yes, we'll make sure that if that needs to be strengthened, I think there's the opportunity in the light of the interim report and then obviously the final report, that if the expert group needs to draw different expertise, or it needs to have more patient voice within it, then I think that's something that we could certainly look at, and perhaps now is the time to do that in the light of the interim report from an independent review. So I think the patient voice around that table is very, very important, and if anyone feels, particularly the women themselves, that there needs to be a stronger voice in the expert group, then that's not something I would stand in the way of at all.
Okay, that's great. I'm sure that response will be welcomed.
Yeah, sure it will be, Angus. Neil.
No point. When the expert group continues its work, if a bit more consideration and sensitivity around where it meets, when it meets, how often it meets, accessibility, the fact that patient representatives in the expert group are doing it through their own time with little support and go through a very exhausting and emotional time. I think that should be considered. Can I ask if there's anything in the interim report that the government doesn't accept at the moment?
First of all, on the point of accessibility and where and when the meetings happen, I think that's a good point. And if we want to look at that, I know that there are women who perhaps are from all parts of Scotland who may wish to be engaged in that group in some way. So we need to think about that. So I'll certainly reflect on what you're saying. In terms of, is there anything in the report we don't accept? No, we accept all of the recommendations. We do understand, however, that some of them may take a bit longer than others to implement. And you know, it's important that we, in the meantime, though, that we get on and the work is done around as much as possible. And as I've said already, I want to be reassured, and certainly the Chief Medical Officer will want to be reassured, that before there's any changes to the processes at the moment, that the safeguards are in place, and if not fully, then certainly interim safeguards. And of course, we also want to be in possession of the full report before any changes are made.
Can I ask if you've read the minority report?
Yes, I have. Received a letter from Olive and Elaine, pointing that out. What I've tried to reassure, and officials have tried to reassure them of, is that there is an opportunity before the production of the final report to look at their views. And understand that Lesley Wilkie had tried to, in her comments, and in to try to encapsulate the views of women who and their strong opinions. Clearly, though, the final report does create an opportunity for that further to be reflected, and I would hope that they've had some reassurance on that.
Just Dr. Wilkie said she hadn't read it when she gave her evidence. Yeah. However, the fact that you have it might be worth sharing with her, and maybe if in not too distant future that there is a government response to that paper, which I think would be very helpful in itself. Can I say I'm very encouraged, Cabinet Secretary, that you are willing to consider the issue of contacting those people who have been fitted with mesh devices. Could I echo what Jackson Carlos said? I think that is absolutely essential. Indeed, I think it's the responsibility of someone, I don't know who, probably government and the NHS, to do that, because I won't ask you the question I asked the previous people giving evidence, but I would just assume that if you or I were fitted with such a device where there was concerns raised, that we would want to know about it. And I think that's just a simple human instinct that I think we have to deal with. Can I ask, in terms of the numbers of people involved, what we see, particularly from the US, I think is very alarming, and the potential impact on Scotland's NHS. So has there been, I've asked this several times in parliamentary questions and not really got any answer. I get a vague answer telling me we understand there's, you know, people have, are taking litigation forward. But has there been an assessment of the potential financial impact on the NHS of hundreds and potentially hundreds more cases, where we see similar cases in the US that are being settled on tens of millions of dollars?
Before I come on to that, can I just confirm that I certainly will respond to the minority report, but also, again, to take the opportunity to reassure them that there is the opportunity to feed into the final report. I mean, in terms of the potential litigation, there is 360 cases at the moment. But of course, the important thing to bear in mind here is that that is on the issue of presumed consent, not about the devices as such, which is a bit different, obviously, from the American cases. Now, the issue of presumed consent arises out of a case that is entirely nothing to do with this issue, but a completely different issue, and actually is an issue for the NHS generally, because it has set a precedent in terms of presumed consent in many cases. And therefore, some work has been done around the impact of that case on presumed consent cases across the NHS, rather than it just being around the issue of mesh, because the issue is the presumed consent rather than the device, if you see what I mean. So there is, without doubt, an impact on the NHS from the landmark case on presumed consent that will have an impact going forward. And it has led, of course, to a lot of change practice around around consent, not just in this issue that we're looking at today, but actually generally. Catherine, do you want to say a little bit about that?
My question was, has there been an analysis of the potential financial impact? That, yes or no, has there been a piece of work done on that?
Not specifically about mesh, no, but I've certainly received some considerable information about the impact of the presumed consent change. So not in relation to mesh specifically, but presumed consent, which is, of course, what is at what the 360 cases are around presumed consent rather than about mesh itself.
Could I ask a final question or make a final point? Do you, one of the issues throughout this has been that the medical establishment has had a real willingness to believe those who said that this was a fantastic procedure and product, and a real unwillingness to believe those who said they had problems. And I think that has been, certainly in my experience, from day one in this, and only up until today have we actually begun to see things change. Mm-hmm. Do you think someone, and I'm not necessarily saying it's you, but do you think someone should apologise to those women who were not believed, and who I think probably there are still many within the medical establishment who still don't believe them? Do you think someone needs to apologise?
Well, look, you know, I'm very happy to apologise to the women for them having to basically have the campaign they've had to have to bring it to everybody's attention, of course. It should never have taken women having to campaign in this way to shine a light on an issue. And, you know, as I've said in my opening remarks, I want to thank them for all that they've done, and they've created and left a legacy for other women that will be better for them. Now, that's probably cold comfort for the ladies sitting behind me, but, you know, absolutely. We need to learn the lessons, I guess, of, you know, we have moved a long way from what is a kind of paternalistic medical model where, you know, doctor knows best, and you know, we have moved a long way from that, but there's still a long way to go, and that is about informed consent, people knowing all of, you know, procedures, all procedures carry a risk, and it's really important that patients, whoever they are and whatever the procedure, know all of those risks, whether it's a procedure, whether it's medication. And, you know, there is something probably about us getting better at the feedback loop of patients who are out there receiving new medicines or new procedures. And, of course, there's always groundbreaking things happening in medicine where there's new procedures and new ways of treating patients. And, you know, we do need to get better at the feedback and the making sure that the research of what those patients then experience comes back into that evidence gathering. And I think we need to be better at that.
Could I say a thank you for that, and a thank you for putting on the record that apology. I wasn't necessarily pushing you to apologise. But now that you have done, would you join me in asking others who we have come across in this long and very painful process to also step up to the plate and make that apology, whether they're from the medical profession itself, whether they're from manufacturers or whoever, that they actually now accept and recognise that many of the concerns that were raised by these women are very genuine concerns, and they were wrong to dismiss them and try to shove them to the side?
Well, look, I can only say what I have said about, you know, my view of the fact that it shouldn't have taken women having to campaign in this way to have their voice heard. And, you know, whether it's government listening or whether it's anybody else out there listening, I think there is something about us being better able to pick up on things at an earlier stage where concerns are raised. And that is something that perhaps, again, this issue has put a spotlight on, that we need to ensure that when concerns are being raised, and that there's ways of us picking up on that and responding to it. And, you know, as I said earlier, women shouldn't have had to have done what they've done to have their voices heard.
If I could say, Mr. Finlay, I think that this has highlighted a real issue where there are women with genuine problems, long-lasting problems, that have come for help and did not receive the help that they should have had from the medical profession.
Absolutely.
I think that we are moving in a direction of more openness and transparency, and I would hope that this interim report and the subsequent final report allow us to move that direction much further forward in Scotland because of this big issue of informed, truly informed consent. And I think that we have already come some way because we do listen to women, we listen to patients more than perhaps we did in the past, but these women have been injured by something that the medical profession did, albeit perhaps with the best intentions, but not with the best information. And so I would reiterate the apology that Cabinet Secretary has said to the women behind me here, who I've met and got to know over a period of time, but also to the other women who aren't here, but who have been part of this campaign.
Okay. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Catherine, for your evidence as well. And it's been, as I said at the outset, I was made aware of how distressing an issue this was for those who have been involved in it. And I can tell from sitting here this morning with almost 2 hours of evidence that the faces of those who are sitting behind you, just how distressing this is for them. We have not completed our work on this, just as the working group and the expert group have not completed their work. But we should take the time to consider what we've heard this morning, and I would suggest that we come back to another meeting of the committee to review the evidence that we've heard and decide how we as a committee will take this forward. And I'd obviously welcome Neil Findlay and John Scott's input to that. If they want to contribute to that ongoing discussion, that would be most helpful to us. We'll take on board everything that we've heard, and we'll obviously contact those who we need to speak to, but it just leaves me this morning to thank the Cabinet Secretary and all of the witnesses who have come this morning to discuss the report, the interim report, with us. I would like to thank everyone who's joined us in the public gallery this morning. I know this has been difficult for you, but on behalf of the committee, thank you very much for all that you have done to raise this issue, and I'm sure you'll continue to do that. And just to add to Jackson's message earlier to Marion Scott, a good example of where the media can be a very positive benefit to those out there who need their voices to be heard. And so congratulations, Marion, on championing this cause on behalf of those who have been affected. And with that, I'll suspend the meeting again so that we can change witnesses. Next item of business this morning is consideration of PE 1480 by Amanda Capel on behalf of the Frank Capel Alzheimer's Awareness Campaign on Alzheimer's and Dementia Awareness. Again, members have a note from the clerks and submissions around this petition. Again, I thank Shona Robison for staying with us. She's the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport. I appreciate her taking out so much time this morning to help us look at the petitions we have before us. The Cabinet Secretary is accompanied by David Fotheringham and Mike Liddell from the Integration and Reshaping Care Division of the Scottish Government. Again, Cabinet Secretary, I'll invite you to make some opening comments and then we'll go to questions on that.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Certainly welcome the opportunity to come back to the committee today and to speak about social care and, in particular, Amanda Copel's petition on charging and dementia awareness. I've met Amanda to discuss her campaign on a number of occasions, most recently on the 25th of September, and I would certainly pay tribute to her tenacity on this issue in memory of her late husband, Frank. At the meeting that I had with Amanda recently, I explained some of the work that we as a government have been doing to improve the fairness and consistency of charges for social care. Over this year, my officials have been working with Professor David Bell from the University of Stirling to fully assess the costs involved in a number of different scenarios around social care charging. We've completed that work and we're now using its findings in looking at the budgets for the spending review period and working out precisely what the best options are to make the system of charging for social care fairer in partnership with local government. And that is at the heart of any changes that we'll make. They have to be fair to everyone with a long-term condition that requires social care. Amanda has widened her petition from its original focus on those with Alzheimer's and dementia to those with other degenerative diseases such as motor neuron disease. And we have to ensure that any charging system would be for people born with a range of conditions, not just those that I've mentioned. So any changes we make to the charging system has to be fair to all service users, and that's the focus of our attention. They also have to be sustainable. We can't make changes to the system now without ensuring that they will be affordable down the line. In addition to the work I've already mentioned, we have over the course of the past year worked with our partners in local government to ensure that some changes have been made, such as those who are assessed by their doctor or consultant as being in the last 6 months of a terminal illness or not charged for the care they receive at home. That has been an important step forward in improving the fairness of the charging system by ensuring that those who only have a short time left are able to spend time with their loved ones without worrying about paying bills for social care. But there is more to do, and as a government we're treating this issue as a priority, and we'll be looking at the best ways to improve the fairness of the charging system for all service users.
Okay, thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. Just to kick off, can I ask, in principle, do you support the aims of this petition?
In principle, I think the petition is calling for something that I agree with, which is a fairer charging system. But what we can't do is to do it for only specific conditions, because you'll understand that if we were to say, so we're going to have a fairer charging system for this list of conditions, there would be another list of conditions of people saying, wait a minute, that's not fair. So what we've had to do is to, and are doing, is looking at how can we make the system fairer for everyone. So the bones of the petition is about a fairer charging system, and that's absolutely where Amanda Copel will get agreement from me. We need a fairer charging system. What we're working on, though, is what that should look like, because you'll appreciate there are various different things we could do. There are various different models. What we need to do is to come up with the fairest one, the best one, the most sustainable one, and, of course, we have to get agreement from local government in taking that forward.
Well, I understand that that's a consideration that we always have to make. I mean, we can't, if everything was a priority, nothing would be a priority. But we do have priorities. There are lots of areas within the health service, within social services, where support is given to one group within our community, but it doesn't apply to others. We have to make those choices. They're difficult choices, but they're choices that are made on a regular basis. Could we not accept that in the case that's brought before us, an example that's given, that this is an area that requires priority, and that while there might be arguments for other areas, we can hear those arguments, but if we accept the principle in relation to Alzheimer's, then we can deal with that problem and move it forward.
Well, my worry would be that if we were to say, for example, that we are going to have a fairer charges system, but only for people with Alzheimer's, that could be legally challenged by someone with another condition. It would say, well, why have you selected only people with Alzheimer's and dementia? And I think, to be fair to Amanda Copel, she's recognised that, and that's why when I met with Amanda recently, she talked about people with life-limiting conditions, that she recognised it had to be broader than just people with Alzheimer's or dementia. And that's why our focus is on looking at how can we bring and reform the system and make it fairer to all service users who are currently having to pay charges.
Okay. And these considerations have to be made, and as I said, we accept that. How long do you think it will take to finalise your deliberation?
Well, we're in the middle, or we're just in the midst of the spending review period. Obviously, we are waiting. We've not heard as yet. We won't until November in terms of what our budgets will look like from UK government decisions. But in advance of that, there is a lot of detailed work going on around the priorities for social care are forming the basis of the discussions we're having with local government. And there are three elements to that. One is fairer charging, the other is progress on living wage, and the other is around capacity, social care capacity. And you'll appreciate these are all issues for social care, and it's about making sure that we can move forward on all of those issues. But we need to get agreement with local government around that, and we need to make sure that within the context of the spending review that we can not just afford it for 1 year, but we can afford it for the entire spending review period.
Okay. And again, in accepting these are all very difficult decisions, we differentiate between some conditions and others in a whole host of areas, but we also differentiate within those conditions between people of a certain age and another. So if we can differentiate within illnesses and conditions, you understand that there's an argument then to say that could be challenged. That if you're over a certain age, you can benefit from a financial support, but if you're below a certain age, you don't. That could be seen as discriminatory. Therefore, allowing someone who has a particular condition to receive support, but someone with a different condition, that's equally a judgment that has to be made at some point.
I think it would be very difficult to, you as a committee would no doubt be sitting with people in front of you saying, hang on a minute, you've made personal care free for those with Alzheimer's and dementia. What about multiple sclerosis? What about motor neuron disease? What about cystic fibrosis? And before long, you would have a petition for looking at and saying that this isn't fair. So rather than wait for that to happen, I've taken the approach that any changes to charging has to be on the principle of fairness and apply to everyone who would be entitled to receive care. I think otherwise we would get into a very difficult position. And as I said earlier, to be fair to Amanda Copel, she's recognised that herself, that you have to look at other degenerative conditions that are life-limiting. You can't just look at one.
Okay. Jackson.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary. Actually, I think the case as you outline it is reasonable, and I understand what you're saying. But can I just be clear, in the work that you've done, have you now, am I right in thinking you have now isolated, or is it the case you have isolated a series of conditions that you think
that this new charging regime would apply to in order for it to be fair, and that what you are now waiting on is the budgetary confirmation as to whether you can go forward, or are you saying that the budgetary confirmation would determine the list or the inclusivity of the basket of conditions, if I can refer to them that way, for which this new regime would apply? Or are you saying that it would just have to be a universal thing, that irrespective of the condition, it would have to be available for absolutely everything? Or are we talking about these kind of particular ones? I'm not just quite clear what you're trying to narrow down here.
We're trying to avoid lists of conditions. So we absolutely don't want to do that, because there'll always be one missing. And that will be the one that will be the next petition to your committee and, you know, to me, to say that's not fair. So we're trying to avoid that scenario. Where we're trying to get to, and of course, you know, people would always have to meet eligibility criteria for care. So this would always be about people who require care rather than have a condition and want care. It would always be around the eligibility and requirements for care. So that will always be there. And what we're trying to get to is a position which is fairer to everybody who at the moment have to pay charges that are can be considerable in some cases. And for those who are under 65, that can be quite challenging. And there are various ways, though, that charging can be made fairer. You can look at free personal nursing care for under 65s, but you can also look at the threshold at which people start to pay charges. So there are various models and ways of making charging fairer. What I'm saying to you is we have not reached our final conclusions on what is the best, what we can get agreement with local government around to deliver, and what is sustainable and affordable. So where the bit we're in at the moment is looking at those various options and discussing those further. So
I think if I'm then understanding it would be a kind of universal provision subject to the eligibility criteria, not actually specifically condition related, because you want to avoid that. I think the threshold thing is actually the subject of another petition that we've been pursuing and which has been with local government for quite some time, as I recall, but that's not necessarily for today. So I suppose I am sort of come back to where the convener got to as to when you would expect to see progress made. Now, you've identified budgetary constraints this year. Is that the point at which you would know what you were going to be able to do? Or is that in itself not going to be the point at which you feel you'll be able to come up with a decision as to how things would progress?
Well, what we decide to do and the policy decisions we make will be part of the spending review, and those announcements will be made in due course. I guess the problem at the moment is we can anticipate and we can make decisions about what we think will be the landscape. But we're not entirely sure of what that landscape looks like until decisions are made elsewhere and we know what budgets are. But despite that, we will be reaching positions about where we would like to get to and what our priorities are within that spending review. And obviously that spending review is a process is one that is quite detailed and, you know, it involves not just my directorates, but is a dialogue with local government and a dialogue with other directorates in government as well. But work has been done on this, quite considerable work actually, to form the basis of how we make those decisions. But there are choices to be made within that about what options we choose. And all of those have merit, but some of them, you know, perhaps have more merit than others, and we need to come to our final conclusions on that.
From what you're saying then, would it be reasonable for the committee to expect, before Parliament suspends at the end of this Parliament next March, that we would have an understanding as to what the government felt it was going to be able to do?
Absolutely.
Right, thank you.
Other questions? I think that's been helpful, Cabinet Secretary. I don't have any other questions. The committee don't appear to have any other questions. I think what we should do, though, is wait to another a future meeting so that we can collate information and get a decision made on how we take forward the petition. Is that okay? Okay.
All thanks, right,
Cabinet
thank
Secretary,
you.
And thanks to your officials for joining you. Okay. I'll suspend again for a few minutes to allow the Cabinet Secretary to leave. Next agenda item is agenda item 4, as consideration of 7 continued petitions. The first continued petition is PE1533 by Jeff Adamson on behalf of Scotland Against the Care Tax on abolition of non-residential social care charges for older and disabled people. Members have a note from the clerk and other submissions for their perusal. Do members have any suggestions on how to take this forward? Jackson?
I kind of feel the Cabinet Secretary indirectly referred to the very matter in the evidence she just gave, because it would seem to me that this is part and parcel of the broader review that she suggested was underway, where she talked about thresholds and other issues too. So I think it would certainly be sensible just to remind the Cabinet Secretary that we would like to ensure that this is incorporated in anything that comes out of that work that's being done.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, I agree actually with Jackson. I think we're coming into an election period. I think what might be useful is just some indication of where they're at in terms of the roundtable discussion, what the ballpark figure is, because at some stage people are going to have to make a decision. As you yourself said, convener, politics is about choices. So some clarity. I can understand they've got to do the number crunching, but at some stage it would be useful for the numbers that are crunched to be available to for be all, and thereafter people can see what the basis of either the manifesto from the government party or indeed alternative manifestos would result in.
Yeah. So we'll be right to the Cabinet Secretary in those terms then? Yeah. Everybody's agreed. John?
Can we suggest we co-join the two petitions for future consideration at this committee, 1480 and the current petition in front of us? Yeah. Because they are, I think, as Mr. Carlo has outlined, very similar in terms of objectives, and it would be useful to, if we're going to get, because clearly we're going to get a report at a later date from the Cabinet Secretary, so it would be useful to consider the two petitions at the same time.
Okay. Everybody happy with that? Okay. Thanks. Next petition is PE1549 by Alan Clark-Young on concessionary travel passes for war veterans. Again, members have documentation around that if they want to make any contributions. I think it is interesting that there is a similar type of project running in London through the Oyster card, which seems to address the issues being brought by the petition. It might be useful to get information on that in terms of costs and other considerations that they had to make before introducing such a programme. That might inform us in terms of how we could take the issue forward. Is that okay?
That's
agreed. Yeah, the next petition is PE1554 by Jack Kelly on behalf of Leonard Cheshire Disability on improving the provision of disabled-friendly housing.
Is on it. I mean, there may again be cost implications that make it unaffordable. There may be technical matters. So I think simply out of courtesy and indeed desire for all appropriate information, asking for clarification would be appropriate.
Yeah. Are you happy with that, Troy?
Yeah, just to
similar to Kenny McCaskill, just to ask the government, what would be the implications of putting two new standards in the building regulations to incorporate lifetime no disability facilities and being going into new homes? Because we are seeing a growth in the number of socially rented houses that are being built, and it would be useful to know if the government are working with local authorities and other social housing providers to ensure they're actually making adequate provision within the new build stock for disabled access and other adaptations to be incorporated in the design of those houses, rather than trying to retrofit at a later date the housing stock, particularly the new housing stock that's been built.
Okay. That seems to be agreed with by the committee. Okay, our next petition, PE1563, by Doreen Goldie on behalf of Avonbridge and Stanburn Community Council on sewage sludge spreading. Okay, do members have any contributions with Angus?
Yes, thanks, Convener. Clearly, the petitioners have responded to SEPA's response, and they do raise a few more questions, which I think the committee should perhaps follow up with SEPA. There are some salient points here that that need clarification, and SEPA are the ones to clarify. So I would, if it's within the committee's remit, I would suggest that we get back to SEPA to seek some clarification on the points raised by the petitioners.
So you want to go specifically to SEPA?
Yeah. Well, also the Scottish Government, because we need some detail as to when the findings of the sludge review and the Scottish Government's response will be made public. So so both the Scottish Government and SEPA.
That seems to be agreed again by the committee. Okay, and the next petition, PE1565 by James Dougal on whole-of-life sentences for violent reoffenders. Comments, Kenny?
We'd send this to the Sentencing Council. It's in the process of being established, but it's soon to be there. I know we've set them other matters to look at, but it does seem to me that this is something that should be part of their workload, and they're the appropriate venue for it.
Agreed. Okay. Agreed. That's agreed. The next petition, PE1566, by Mary Hemphill and Ian Reid on a national service delivery model for warfarin patients. Colleagues, have any comments to make on this? It would appear that people who know better than me have suggested the University of Birmingham Primary Care Department are involved in this, and it would be useful to contact them to get more information that would inform our considerations of the petition. Everybody happy with the recommendations made? Yep, okay, that's agreed. And the final continued petition is PE1568 by Catherine Hughes on funding, access and promotion of NHS Centre for Integrative Care. I think the members have had a chance to look at the paperwork around this and are more familiar with the discussions around this petition than I have been up until now, so we welcome your recommendations on how to deal with it. What do you think? Is it worth going back to the government to explore some of the areas that have been raised?
I would be keen to go back to the government and explore some of the issues that have been raised by the petitioner. But with the committee's indulgence, I think it may be useful to bring in a couple of health boards to actually discuss and ask questions about the decisions that were made to withdraw the funding for the integrated care provision, because the difficulty is this service can only be continue if the individual health boards contribute to it. And as we know from the petitioner and others, that a number of the health boards have now decided to withdraw the funding and not make any new referrals. Ongoing referrals will continue as long as they are required, but there will be no new referrals, and particularly Lanarkshire Health Board is one of those, and I would be interested to hear their views as to the process that they took to make the decision to withdraw the funding, and what alternatives that they are putting in place for patients who have identified that type of the treatment path, because clearly the petitioner has indicated that not only has Lanarkshire Health Board decided not to continue to make new referrals, but they've also they've decided to close two of the clinics that were provided in the Health Board area as well. So, as I said, it might be useful to question the Health Board in those areas and to find out, so we can get a better idea of, and question the Scottish Government at a later date about how they would actually envisage that centre, the national centre, continuing to deliver services for the whole of Scotland if local health boards are withdrawing the funding.
Excellent. I have a slight concern, and it is that we're bordering on, I think, finding ourselves entering into a much larger inquiry on the merits of homeopathic care. And I'm not sure that, I think if we were, if that is our intention, then we would have to understand that that's what we were doing. The government doesn't have a policy on homeopathic care. There is no national guidance to health boards on homeopathic care. And I'm slightly uncertain as to whether or not that's for this committee to do, or whether, if we felt that it was appropriate, such a review should take place, that it's not something that shouldn't be remitted to the Health and Sport Committee to undertake if they felt that that was appropriate.
Yeah. Do you think we're at that point just now, Jackson, or could we write?
I'm slightly nervous. I understand where John Wilson's coming from. I'm slightly nervous that once we start bringing health boards in, we're going to be asking them, why aren't they doing it? Sure. And I can see inevitably we're going to then get into an immediate discussion as to whether or not they believe in homeopathic care, because presumably they don't if they're not. So then we get into the unevenness of the way in which homeopathic medicine is treated across Scotland, and that is quite a big job of work. And, and I'm not sure that actually it isn't a matter that I don't know whether the Health and Sport Committee have in fact discussed it in recent times or not, but it seems to me that if such a review is going to take place, it's more appropriately led from there than from here, I think is where I would feel.
Yeah, I do take on board that point, but equally, if we're trying to understand, it seems to be about funding and access, not about whether there should or shouldn't be homeopathy at the moment. But I can understand what you're saying, Jack. We could start to stray into that territory if we start to analyse, you know, health boards' attitude towards homeopathy. But it might be useful to get the views of Highland Health Board and Lanarkshire Health Board as to what drove their decisions, if we haven't already obtained that information, and see where we go. So we should continue this, but try and get more information just to inform the committee about the types of decisions that had to be made around funding. Is that okay? Do you think that would prevent us from going too far into the...
That's your discretion. I mean, I'm not being prescriptive about this. I just, I'm anxious that, I mean, I don't know that I'm inclined to see the committee kind of immerse itself to that.
I
think it goes slightly beyond the terms of the petition.
If we stick to the funding, because it's about funding and access, if we ask them to explain the funding decision, but purely that, I think we stay within the boundaries of the petition. We're not asking about whether they support or don't support homeopathy. Right. I think health boards might support a lot of procedures but can't afford them.
Yeah.
So if we stick to the considerations around funding, we're not asking them to debate the merits or otherwise of homeopathy. Is that okay if we write to them in those terms?
Yep.
Is that okay?
Agreed.
There
are three NHS boards, not just Highland and Lanarkshire. There's NHS Lothian as well.
All right, okay. So if they're affected, we could ask them.
Yeah.
Okay, that concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. We're now going into private session to debate agenda items 5 and 6.